Jesus, thank you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. We praise your name, Lord. We praise your holy name. Hallelujah. Glory to your name. We praise you, Lord Jesus. Be bold.
Thank you.
worship you, Lord. We praise your name, Lord. We thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to your name, Lord. We praise your name. Hallelujah. How I Hallelujah, glory. Thank you. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. We worship you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to your name. Hallelujah. Glory to your name, Lord. We worship you, Lord. You're my one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. You're my one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I I just feel the need to sing that today. You're my one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Lord, I need you, Lord. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. So teach my song to rise with you. When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. So teach my song to rise with you. When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Hallelujah, we worship your name, we worship you, Lord. Hallelujah, we worship your name. Hallelujah, we praise you, Lord, we praise you, Lord. Hallelujah, glory to your name, Lord. Hallelujah. We worship your name, Lord. We praise you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. We praise your name. We glorify your name, Lord. We worship you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. We praise your name. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship your name, Lord. Hallelujah, we worship your name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah.
They have heard of me. They know of me, but the world does not know me. The harvest truly is great, the laborers are few. You are my laborers, saith the Lord. I have filled you with my spirit. I pour my spirit upon you. I speak to you through the spirit in preparation for you to be my laborers, saith the Lord. Go and witness, be laborers in the harvest, and I will fill this house, my house. I will fill this house, one mind, one heart, and one soul at a time, saith the Lord God.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Yes, stand up. Be bold, as you have sung. Go out into the world, for I am the Lord thy God. And yes, people need to know. People need to know. Stand up and move forward. As I have told you in the past, stand up, look to me, be bold, and trust in my ways. For I am the Lord thy God. And I am with you, and I will not leave you. I will be with you through this all.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, we praise your name, Lord Jesus. Lord, we thank you today. Your encouraging words. Not just encouraging words, Lord, but Lord, words of a call, words of a action, call to action. Lord, I pray today, as you have said, Lord, your anointing is in this place. Your Holy Spirit comes. Comes freely and ministers in such a precious and powerful way, confirming your word with signs and wonders, giving us direction, showing us the way, and encouraging us to stay the course, to be on the path. Lord, I thank you and praise you today for all that you do in our lives, for the strength you give us from day to day. Without you, we could do nothing. Without you, we are nothing. You're the glory and the lifter of our head. You are very present help in time of need. You're the strong tower that we run to, where we are safe in the arms of our Heavenly Father. There's healing in your wings. There's healing in your name. Lord, we just come before you. Lord, and we lift up every physical need, every infirmity, every sickness in the name of Jesus. Lord, and I pray for miracles. Miracles, Lord. You're a miracle-working God, Lord. Do miracles today. Miracles in your house, Lord. Testimonies of your healing power, Lord, for the world to see as you have told us. Lord, for every need that is presented here today, you know, Lord, the needs and the cry of your people's heart, Lord. Maybe it's financial, maybe it's emotional. Maybe the enemy, Lord, is attacking minds. We know he is, Lord. Lord, I just pray in Jesus' name, the author and the finisher of our faith, Lord Jesus, that you would answer, Lord, that you would come in your precious and powerful way. And Lord, you would answer the prayer, Lord. You would come, Lord, and you would meet that need. That you, Lord, have already spoken, Lord, through us corporately, Lord, but you might speak to us individually. Lord, that you might speak, Lord, words of individualism, individualistic words to us, Lord, to us specifically, Lord, to speak to us, that we might hear, that we might know, Lord. Lord, I pray today, as you're in this house, as you have graced us with your presence again, Lord, even though we're imperfect and we are human, your love is so great, your mercy is so great, our minds cannot even comprehend it. We can't even grasp it or fathom how much you love us, how much we mean to you. The signs are all around of your unending love, in your mercy, in your grace. Lord, I pray today, Lord, would be a new day for somebody. Lord, maybe they're listening or watching this, Lord. May you speak through your Spirit, Lord. Change our lives. Make us more like you. Give us your strength. Give us your wisdom. And your power, Lord, that we might go out and be your witnesses, Lord. That your light may shine through us. That what we do, what we say, how we act, and all, Lord, would reflect on you and reflect the glory of your goodness, of your love and your mercy, Lord. I pray today. We thank you, Lord, for we know that, Lord, when we ask, an answer is coming. Lord, you are the God that hears and answers. You know where we're at. You know what we're going through. And you're more than all of it. You're more than all of it, Lord, and you get us through. You get us through in your strength and your power. Make today that day, Lord, today in this house, your house, Lord, a house of worship. We give you praise, Lord. And we thank you for your answers. We thank you, Lord, in Jesus' mighty name. And everybody said, amen. Hallelujah. Glory to your name, Lord. Hallelujah. Let's continue to worship the Lord today with our giving. If ushers would come forward. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord Jesus. Lord, we thank you for your blessing and your provision. As I said, Lord, we would have nothing without you, and we are nothing, Lord, can do nothing without you. So, Lord, I pray today as your people return to you a portion of what you've given us. Lord, as we give to you, Lord, I pray your blessing on their giving, Lord. Bless them, pressed down, shaken together, running over, in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ah, Lord God, thou hast made the heavens and the earth by thy great power. Ah, Lord God, thou hast made the heavens and the earth by thy outstretched arm. Nothing is too difficult for thee. Nothing is too difficult for thee. Great and mighty God, great and powerful. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, worship team. Nothing is too difficult for him. Amen. All right, you're with me. Praise God. Glory to God. Before I get into my message, which we're going to continue in our series, walking according to God's word. If you have ears to hear what the Spirit would say. He's speaking to us. Hear what he has to say. I put it in wrong order, Darla. If you can do the next slide after the scriptures, the one that my hope. I came across this and I thought I'd share it with you today. My hope is in the Lamb. Amen? Amen. Glory to God. I want to continue the series today. The Lord says to continue the series. We're in the chapter 12 of the book of Revelation. And I believe that the Lord has really given us a fresh revelation so that we have an understanding of what's happening in the world and how it all fits into what's taking place in his plan. I share with you a few weeks ago, somebody said, how close do you think we are? And I responded with, I don't know. Close enough. I don't know how close we are because I share with you that, hey, you know, things rapidly increased in the past 3 years. I'll call it the last days period has kind of like been on steroids the past 3 years. And it's been at a fast pace, the hamster on the wheel. And so I don't know. I said, you know, I don't know if the Lord will level off again or will it continue at this pace and will it continue to increase? We'll see, I guess. Time will tell, right? Amen. Unless the Lord speaks something to you specifically, he hasn't told me. So it gives us a better understanding as we see what's happening here and what's going on. Let's go to chapter 12. We're going to read verses 1 through 5. I think I did 7 verses last week. I was rather ambitious, but you know we got through 2 verses. So praise the Lord. We'll get through another 3 verses today. Amen? Amen. The first, Revelation chapter 12, verse 1, and a great sign appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet, and her head a crown of 12 stars. She was pregnant and was crying out in birth pains, in the agony of giving birth. And another sign appeared in heaven, behold, a great red dragon with 7 heads and 10 horns on his head, 7 diadems. His tail swept down a third of the stars of heaven and cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman who was about to give birth, so that when she bore her child, he might devour. She gave birth to a male child, one who is to rule the nations with a rod of iron. But her child was caught up to God and on his throne. Lord, I thank you today for your Holy Spirit. I thank you, Lord, that your Spirit came and you have spoken and you have ministered to us already. But Lord, I pray now as I'm about to deliver your word, it be your words and not mine. I pray today, Lord, that we might rightly divide your truth. I pray that you'd hide me behind the cross, that I might deliver this without error, Lord, and that it would be accurate. And I thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. If we go back a couple weeks ago to chapter 11 in the closing part of it, we see 24 elders are falling on their faces. They're worshiping God. They're giving him thanks again and again, and they're acknowledging that he is God Almighty. He is who is and who was. He is from everlasting to everlasting. They're also acknowledging that the nations have raged, that there have been plots against God. The nations have come against Israel and have come against God and his plan. But they also acknowledge and they thank him for that his plan will go forth and that his judgment and that his wrath will be poured out on those who have come against him and those who have failed to accept his son, Jesus Christ. That wrath and judgment came, and they are thankful that he is rewarding his servants, the prophets and the saints, and all who have feared his name. And we finish the chapter 11 with John. He saw God's temple in heaven opened, and he could see the Ark of the Covenant within the temple. And there were flashes of lightning, thunder, rumblings, peals of thunder, an earthquake, and heavy hail. Going ahead, we go back and forth here because there's so many references, but just incidentally, Revelation in chapter 16, it talks about a plague of hail that fell, that the hailstones weighed about 100 pounds per hailstone. That's not even thinkable, is it? 100 pounds. So I thought I'd add, that was a note in the scripture, and I thought I'd add that for you. 100-pound hailstones. Wow. See, when God does something, it's not small. Amen? We think things in Texas are big, but no, when God does something, he does it in a big way. Last week, we began chapter 12 with John seeing a great sign in heaven. This great sign that he sees is a woman clothed with the sun, the moon under foot, and a crown of 12 stars on her head. John's telling us it was a great sign in heaven, and he tells us what the woman is that she is symbolic and that it is not a literal woman. The interpretation of this sign is important, and some believe that it's Mary who is pregnant with Jesus to give birth to him. But this has already taken place, and it's historical, so Mary is still not pregnant. Hold that thought. We'll be going to that in a few more minutes. While others believe that she represents the church, among other reasons, the church does not birth anything, so it can't be the church. The church is not birthing anything. So the woman represents Israel, and the sun and the moon take us back to Joseph's dream in Genesis chapter 37, verse 9 through 10. It's truly amazing. If you study the book of Revelation, you will encompass, and I'll close with this again. No, don't get nervous. Don't get excited. I'm not closing now. But when I do close, it's truly amazing how we go back to the Old Testament. I've always said, you know, the Old Testament, people say, oh, it's just a bunch of stories. No, the Old Testament is fulfilled in the New Testament. And, you know, Christ is fulfilled. So many prophecies in the Old Testament are fulfilled in the New Testament. I want to read that scripture in Genesis again so that we get that. In verse 9 of 37, then he dreamed another dream and told it to his brothers. Remember when Joseph did this? He wasn't taken too lightly from his brothers. Behold, I have dreamed another dream. Behold, the sun, the moon, and 11 stars were bowing down to me. What's interesting and what's wonderful is that verse 10 gives us the answer to who Joseph is talking about. But when he told it to his father and to his brothers, his father rebuked him and said to him, what is this dream that you have dreamed? Shall I and your mother and your brothers indeed come to bow ourselves to the ground before you? The answer we know is yes, that will happen. And I told you last week that I actually reread through that whole story again and read through it. And what a great number of miracles that took place in that. It's just what his brothers meant for evil, God meant for good. God had a whole plan for everything that took place. See, there's so many encouraging things. I love stories. We did a story on Thursday night. We did a story about Samson. And I love the stories of the Old Testament because we can be encouraged by those. They're not just stories. They're in there for a purpose. They're in there for us to get truth from, and they're in there to encourage us in our daily walk with the Lord. The 11 stars were Joseph's brothers, and with him that makes 12. They're the 12 sons of Jacob, which make up the 12 tribes of Israel. This woman is pregnant, and she's enduring agonizing pain, pain that is associated with the agony of giving birth. This is all the pain and anguish of Israel throughout the Bible, the persecution, the attempted destruction and annihilation of the Jewish people throughout history. Today, the persecution continues, and all the travails of Israel will be until what? We talked about this several weeks ago. Until the accomplishment of God's purpose. The terror, the horrors, some of which are because of God's own chosen people, because they have turned their backs on God, because they have refused to accept his son. Many of the things that have come against them have been because of their disobedience. And while the rest is the hatred of Satan, the enmity between Satan and Jewish people and the nation of Israel that produced Christ, that would crush his head, ending Satan's age-long plot to overthrow God and take his throne. That's what this is all about. I want you to really understand. He's in the microphones too. I want you to understand. That's what this is all about, you see. Satan's at the very middle of this, and his hate for Israel is at the middle of this also because they produced Jesus, the Son of God, that would crush his head. And anything and anybody, which includes us, that is in the way of his plan, he is trying to destroy. Anybody that's in the way of his plan. And actually, he wants us to be deceived that we can believe his trash and believe that we can be gods. That's what he's telling the world. And we can be like God, just like he's going to be like God. But he really knows what's going to happen. So that's why he's so vicious. We'll talk about that in a second also. So the first thing we're going to look at today is another sign in verse 3. There's another sign in verse 3. And another sign appeared in heaven, and behold, a great dragon with 7 heads and 10 horns, and on his head 7 diadems. Let's go back to, I said this a moment ago, Genesis 3:15, I will put enmity between you and the woman, between your offspring and her offspring. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. Interestingly enough, in this verse, there's two principal characters, the woman and the serpent, right? The woman and the serpent. Similarly, John sees two signs. The word sign in the Greek is Simeon, and I told you that last week, and it means wonders. In the first woman, and then the serpent, the dragon. In the Greek, the word dragon is drakon. And you know what it means? It means large or fabulous serpent is the devil, Satan. Large or fabulous serpent is the devil, Satan. And in another note, the term dragon is only used in the New Testament in the book of Revelation. I got to word this right so it sounds right. The term dragon is used in the Old Testament, but in the New Testament, it is only used in the book of Revelation, interestingly enough. So we look at verse 9, we're go ahead of ourselves a little bit, of chapter 12, and it says this, and the great dragon was thrown down, and the ancient serpent who is called the devil and Satan and deceiver of the world, he was thrown down to the earth, and his angels were thrown down with him. Now let's go a little bit farther ahead to Revelation 13:4, and they worshiped the dragon, for he had given his authority to the beast, and they worshiped the beast, saying, who is like the beast, and who can fight against us? And then back to the Old Testament in Isaiah. In that day, the Lord with his hard and great and strong sword will punish Leviathan, the fleeing serpent, Leviathan, the twisting serpent, and he will slay the dragon that is in the sea. The dragon's given a name here in the Old Testament. And you know, Leviathan, interestingly enough, means twisted, curled, large sea monster or large sea animal. And it has to do with. So we've seen this, and one more scripture, Revelation 13:1 says, and I saw a beast rising out of the sea with 10 horns and 7 heads with 10 diadems on his horns and blasphemous names on his heads. Why did I give you all those scriptures? They're ahead. We're not going to, they mean something to today. We won't study them in the context of that chapter until we get there. But what they mean today, and I give them to you today, is that this is, the dragon is Satan. The dragon is Satan himself. And I want us to understand, though, that we see these hideous pictures of Satan. And that John sees this sign, and Satan does not look like a hideous dragon or sea monster in appearance. Ezekiel 28 tells us that he is a beautiful angel, and that it is his very beauty that corrupted him. He thought, you know, I'm all it. He looked in the mirror and thought he was beautiful. He was the greatest of all the angels. And he wasn't, remember we talked about this, he wasn't happy with where he was at. He wanted more. He wanted, why can I not be like God? How come he gets to be God? Boy, doesn't that sound familiar today? How come they get to be? How come he gets to be God? So Satan, the dragon, represents the hideous and horrifying nature and character of Satan. His destructive, murderous, lying, deceitful, hate-filled being that he is. That's what the dragon describes. It describes his nature and how he is and what he's like, truly what we would say on the inside, who he is. He's not hideous. The Bible tells us that he was beautiful. But as a person, he's a hideous and horrible thing. All this evil is embodied not in Satan's appearance, but in his character. So let's look at the 7 heads and the 10 horns on his head. And to do that, in the 7 diadems. Diadems are crowns or wreaths, remember? So let's look at this. And in order to do that, we have to jump ahead a little bit again. Revelation chapter 17, verse 9 through 17. This calls for a mind with wisdom. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman is seated. There are also seven kings, five of whom have fallen. One is, and the other has not yet come. And when he does come, he must remain only a little while. As for the beast that was and is not, I was taking very specific note when I read that. And the beast, what is that telling us? It's telling us something right there. Now, we're not studying the scripture in this till we get there, but I thought this was very empowering. As the beast that was and is not. What do they say about the Lord? He was and he is. The beast was, but he ain't gonna always be. To use good English, right? He ain't always gonna be. So I thought that's just interesting. Going on, it is an eighth, but it belongs to the seven, and it goes to destruction. And the ten horns that you saw are ten kings who have not yet received royal power, but they are to receive authority as kings for 1 hour together with the beast. They are of one mind, and they hand over their power and authority to the beast. They will make war on the Lamb. The Lamb will conquer them, for he is Lord of lords and King of kings, and those with him are called and chosen and faithful. And the angel said to me, the waters that you saw where the prostitute is seated are peoples and multitude and nations and languages. And the ten horns that you saw, they and the beast will hate the prostitute. They will make her desolate and naked and devour her flesh and burn her up with fire. For God has put it into their hearts to carry out his purpose by being of one mind and handing over their royal power to the beast until the words of God are fulfilled. Now, I know I read all of that, and that's not yet. Chapter 17, who knows? We could be in the new year to 17, but so we're not going to get to that. But what I want us to see is about the description that we see here of the seven heads, the ten horns, and the diadems. Go to Daniel chapter 7, verse 23 and 4. Thus he said, as the fourth beast, there shall be a fourth kingdom on earth, which shall be different from all the kingdoms, and it shall devour the whole earth, and trample it down, and break it to pieces. And for the ten horns out of this kingdom, ten kings shall arise. Wow. Isn't that interesting? The book of Daniel, in the book of Revelation. Go figure. And another shall arise after them. He shall be different from the former ones, and he shall put down three kings. So what are these? Seven heads, ten horns, and seven diadems. They represent political power and nations that will persecute in the tribulation. And that they represent these powers. They will align themselves with the Antichrist, and they will seek the destruction of the people and the nation of Israel. I'm not going to go into 17. We'll go into that, and we'll go down that rabbit hole when we get to 17 about all of that stuff. But what I want us to see here are these will be the powers that will come into power during the tribulation. There are some that believe that it will actually be a reinstated or it may represent a reconstructed or revised Roman Empire during the tribulation. So what will happen is these nations will rise, and they're going to be fighting for power. It's going to, remember what we said when we first started reading this, wars, and there's everyone for themselves. So everybody wants power. Can you imagine that? Everybody wants power with no Holy Spirit restraint during that time. They'll align with the Antichrist, and it's to persecute the woman. We'll talk about that in a second. Satan's followers are with him, and this is all, again, goes back to Satan's plot. What is this all about? And it's God's judgment. It's his judgment on earth and the people of earth for falling into the deceitful plan of Satan to try, and God will exact his wrath and his judgment. So that's what John sees, another sign. And here, next, secondly, we look at Satan's followers. In verse 4, his tail swept down a third of the stars of heaven and cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman who was about to give birth, so that when she bore her child, he might devour her. Other Bible versions use the word drew. And his tail drew them down a third of the stars from heaven. And some note that the word drew is past tense, noting that this may be what has taken place. And it represents all those who followed Satan when he was cast out of heaven for trying his rebellion. The Greek word is suro, and it means to drag away by force. It's also used in John in dragging the nets, and it's also used in Acts when they were dragging Paul out of the city, to drag someone by force. If we go to Daniel chapter 8, verse 9 through 10, out of one of them came a little horn which grew exceedingly great toward the south, toward the east, and toward the glorious land. It grew great even to the host of heaven, and some of the host and some of the stars it threw down to the ground and trampled them. All of this, see, talking about stars. I'm going to get ahead of myself here. God, let's go to Jude chapter 6 first before it. In Jude chapter 6, the angels who did not stay within their own position of authority but left their proper dwelling, he has kept in eternal chains under gloomy darkness until the judgment of the great day. Angels are often referred to as stars in the Bible, and here we see a third of the angels. We are told that a third of the angels were swept with Satan. It's almost like I get this idea that, well, first of all, they bought his lies, and come on, we're gonna go against God, and we're gonna be gods too, like him. And what happens? He gets thrown out, and his tail sweeps and grabs him on the way out. The tail, I would think, is his deception, and they were drawn in and dragged in by his deception. Just as many are dragged in by his deception today. But that's a whole nother message. For us today, his followers, the stars represent the angels that have fallen with him. Verse 9 of chapter 12 again, we read it again. And the great dragon was thrown down, the ancient serpent who is called the devil and Satan, the deceiver of the whole world. He was thrown down to earth, and his angels were thrown down with him. Get out of here. Earth's a good place for you. The dragon or Satan stands before the woman so that he may devour the child when it is born. So Satan's followers, John sees a sign, another great sign. It's a dragon, this hideous thing. And there's representations there. It's a sign. And the woman, the dragon is standing or is waiting for the woman to give birth so he can devour that. So thirdly, let's look at the male child again. Revelation chapter 12, verse 5. She gave birth to a male child, one who is to rule all the nations with a rod of iron, but her child was caught up to God and to his throne. And last week, I gave you several reasons. I talked about many that believe that their child is Christ. But this week I was exposed to a different idea as to who that may be. And there's a compelling argument that it may not be Christ for reasons that I just mentioned before. So let's look at that today. The reasons we talked about people might believe that this male child is Jesus, because there's a lot of factors there that look it to be. Isaiah tells us To us a child is born, and to us a son is given. The government shall be on his shoulders. There will be no end to his reign and ruling. And that we know that to be Christ. He will rule the nations with a rod of iron, and before the dragon could devour the child, he's caught up to the throne. We just read that scripture. The word rule, incidentally, in the Greek means to shepherd. The word used here, rule, means to shepherd. So there you go. You know, it looks like it. It just looks like it. But here's the thing. Jesus' birth and ascension have already taken place. And he is ruling and reigning. And he will rule the nations. But ruling the nations with a rod of iron is spoken of here in Revelation during the time of judgment in the millennium. Or not the millennium, the tribulation, I'm sorry. Some would say, well, it's a male child and it's singular, not representing a group of people. But so is the woman singular, and she represents Israel, or a group of people. So what am I getting at? Follow me. Follow me along here. This is a rabbit hole we're going down. So I talked about the woman that is Israel can't be married because she's already physically given birth to Jesus, and therefore she's not pregnant in heaven, right? We said that. So if we use the same logic, remember in my introduction I said hold that thought? So if we use the same logic, how could the child be Jesus? Yes, he came from the nation of Israel, but again, he was born 2,000 plus years ago. He's already ascended, so how could John be seeing the historical ascension of Christ as taking place during the tribulation? It doesn't happen in the tribulation. So there's another compelling argument that was brought to my attention this weekend, and that the male child is a group of people, and that would be the 144,000 Jewish sealed people. And we'll look at just a few reasons why that is and how they fit into there. Isaiah predicts Israel bringing forth the male child before she is delivered at the end of the tribulation. That's important. And where do we read that? Isaiah 66. We read this last week. Verse 7, before she was in labor, she gave birth. Before her pain came upon her, she delivered a son. Who has heard such a thing? Who has seen such things? Shall a land be born in one day? Shall a nation be brought forth in one moment? For as soon as Zion was in labor, she brought forth her children. So Revelation 14, going ahead again a little bit. Then I looked, and behold, on Mount Zion stood the Lamb, and with him 144,000 who had his name and his father's name written on their foreheads. Remember, we talked about them. And I heard a voice from heaven like the roar of many waters and like the sound of loud thunder. And the voice I heard was like the sound of a harpist playing on their harps. And they were singing a new song before the throne and before the four living creatures and before the elders. No one could learn that song except the 144,000 who had been redeemed from the earth. That's important. Who had been redeemed from the earth. It is these who have not defiled themselves with women, for they are virgins. It is these who follow the Lamb wherever he goes. Also note here, these have been redeemed from mankind as first fruits of God for the Lamb. In verse 5, and in their mouth no lie was found, for they are blameless. This is thought to be in the second three and a half, or the last 3.5 years of the tribulation. And we see Mount Zion is spoken about. We're there. And in Hebrews chapter 12, 22 tells us what Mount Zion is. But you have come to Mount Zion, to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to innumerable angels in festal gathering. Innumerable angels. More than we can count in festal gathering. So these 144,000 are sealed for protection through the first six trumpets of judgment. And we went through those through in Revelation 7 through 9. Those first six trumpets. The dragon is waiting to devour the child, and they are protected during those first six trumpets, and Satan wants to destroy them, and he's seeking to destroy them in the seventh trumpet. But they're protected from the wrath of Satan under the seventh trumpet by God catching them up to heaven. So they, this group, are represented, and they're caught up to God and his throne and delivered from the wrath of the dragon and our heavenly people. If we look at Revelation, we go back to Revelation chapter 2, verse 7. This is, so we think about this. The one thing that, one of the many things that initially went into my head was, how can it be them? It talks about ruling the nations, and that's Christ. Well, it is Christ, but not just Christ. So let's go back in Revelation, and let's look at chapter 2 of Revelation. First, verse 7 says, "He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who conquers, I will grant to eat of the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God." Look at that. The devil doesn't get to do that. Everything he wanted, it's right there. Ha ha. Isn't that it? That just came to me. Lord just showed. Those who conquer, those believers that finish the race, get to eat from the tree of life in heaven. Verse 11 now of chapter 2. "He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. The one who conquers will not be hurt by the second death." And then here it is in verse 26 and verse 27 of chapter 2. "The one who conquers and who keeps my works until the end, to him will I give authority over the nations, and he will rule. Who's he? The one who conquers will rule with a rod of iron, as when earthen pots are broken to pieces, even as I myself have received authority from the Father." The rule used here again is shepherd. Will shepherd. So Revelation 3:21 says, "The one who conquers, I will grant to him to sit with me on the throne, and also conquered and sat down with the Father on his throne." So lastly, of all this, throughout the biblical history, Satan in his plot against God and his aspirations to be God has messed with God's creation. We all agree with that, right? And he's still messing with God's creation to deceive and to destroy. Jesus told us what? The thief comes to what? Kill, steal, and destroy. Or whatever in the steal, kill, and destroy, whatever order you want to put him in. He is the believer's adversary. The devil is the believer's adversary, the dragon. And he is like a roaring lion looking for people to devour. Another sermon for another day, but he tried to prevent the birth of Jesus, the Messiah. He tried to deceive Jesus. I'll give you all of this if you just bow to me. And ultimately, he tried to destroy Jesus. He must have thought he had it all done when he was on the cross. He must have thought, "I won this once and for all." And why is he doing all this? Because he knows what is coming to him from Jesus. And for this, he hates Israel and hates them for producing the Messiah who will come and who will crush his head. It would only stand to reason then that Satan would want to devour the 144,000 Jews, Jewish believers that are sealed and protected by God. Why? Because they're preaching Jesus in the tribulation, and that will be a menace to his plan, and he'll be trying to stop them, and it is a menace to his plan, and it stops him, and it continues to the plan of God, and he knows what's coming. And they're out there preaching. And they're out there, and he's going to want to devour them. And that's what it is. And before they can be devoured, the Lord takes them from the earth and takes them out. They've done their time. Remember, everything is in God's timeline. And I know I've thrown a lot at you, so that's why it's good that you can always listen to this or you can always watch it again if you want to, if you missed something or I didn't quite understand that. These chapters refer, one thing about the book of Revelation, the chronology gets messed up sometimes, and where we are now, we're jumping back and forth. You know, when we were going through in the beginning, it's somewhat chronological, but now that chronology is on pause, is in hold, and now we're talking about, we're going back to the first 3.5 years of the tribulation again. And then now we, you know, talk about just before the last 3.5 years are to start. The woman is Israel. Can't be the church, can't be Mary. The child to be born from the woman seems more like being the 144,000 Jewish people, because of what we talked about, Christ has already been born. And they're in Mount Zion in heaven with him. They're seen in heaven by John later on in chapter 17. Having been taken out before they can be destroyed. And they did what they were supposed to do. And their dragon, we are told by the scripture, is Satan. And again, we see all these hideous pictures of him. We can't take his appearance. That is not his appearance. It is his nature and his character that is hideous. And that is what is hideous about him. Also, I forgot, you know, his name in the Old Testament, in Isaiah, was Leviathan, and that means twisted. Large sema, twisted and curled. He's certainly twisted and curled, that's for sure. And if you think about all those descriptions of him, and this is what we see. Go back to his rebellion. Go back to Adam and Eve in Genesis. I will put enmity between you, serpent, Satan, and the woman. The woman's Eve, but the woman represents Israel. Israel brings forth all of his opposition, and we are his opposition. Although the church isn't mentioned here, the church is his opposition today. Amen? What was the Holy Spirit telling us today? Get out there. The harvest is great. The labors are few. Let's get out there and start to harvest. And why would he be telling all of this? So that we have the answers to questions. Just so happens, wink, wink, you know, people ask questions about this stuff now. This is in the forefront. All of a sudden, when we see all these signs happening, the book of Revelation becomes very relevant to people that are not believers. So what does this mean? And we should understand in our world today why Israel is so important. Israel is the focal point of history, for biblical history, and where we are headed in the future. The Bible tells us that. That's not me just spouting that off, and this isn't something I just came up with. This is what the Bible's telling us, and this is what the Bible's showing us. So let's wrap it up today. This study of the book of Revelation has us traversing throughout both the Old and the New Testament. And I hope and pray that you, like I, are gaining a better understanding of what is to come. And we also are seeing what history has had and what current events and how history and current events are a fulfillment of God's plan and purpose in the scripture. And I close with the scripture I had last week, but you didn't get to read with me, but you get to read it with me today. I love this. So, as Paul would say to the Romans, So what do we make of all these things? What do we make of all these things? I love that. So we can ask ourselves, so what is this all about? That's what Paul's saying. What shall we make of these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? Nail it. He did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all. How will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Nail it. Who shall bring any charges against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, who was raised? Who is at the right hand of God? Who is indeed is interceding for us? Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake, we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. What shall we think of all these things? That's what we need to think of all these things. Interesting, nor angels. What angels is he talking about? The angels we were just talking about. What we discover in all of this, the resounding message through all of this that we're doing is this, that because of God's love, his mercy, and his grace, he is fully engaged with all his might and his power to protect, provision, and care for you and I, saints, and all his believers. Will somebody say amen with me? Satan is constantly looking for people to destroy in his plot against God. All the while, God stands in Satan's way for those who choose to follow him through his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. Amen? I want to say that again. Can you get that? Satan is constantly looking for people to destroy. He's looking to destroy you and I. He's looking to destroy our families, our children. He's looking to destroy churches. He's looking to destroy everything that is about God in his plot against God. All the while, God stands in Satan's way. He raised up the standard. When the enemy came in like a flood, he raised up a standard. He stands in the way for those who will choose to follow him through his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. And everybody said, amen. Glory to God. Lord, I thank you today for your precious word. I thank you for your mercy, your grace. That is all sufficient. Lord, I thank you that we can glean truth from your word. And Lord, we can understand why the world is such a mess. It's a mess by humans choosing, but a fulfillment of what you knew would take place. So Lord, I pray today as you have commissioned us, You have called us and you have reiterated this commission and this calling to us today in this place through your Holy Spirit. And you have encouraged us that you are our strength in this, that you are, Lord, the power that propels us, that gives us the ability to do as we need to do. So, Lord, I pray today as we have studied your word, that we would know that in all these things, we are more than conquerors. In all this stuff that we're talking about, we don't need to go through that. We don't need to see that time of tribulation. But that you will get us through the distresses of this life that we see taking place and we see increasing over and over. And Lord, I pray today for your wisdom and your strength. I pray that we might be soldiers with courage for you. It isn't always easy, and actually most of the time it's not easy. But we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. Lord, I thank you for that. I thank you that you didn't send us off on a road by yourself and tell us you'll meet us at the finish line and you hope we get there. You said, let's go run the race. I'm right beside you. Let's run, and let's run with a purpose that we might finish the race, having achieved and been found faithful and done what we are supposed to do. Lord, we pray for you to give us the strength to do that. Give us the wisdom in decision making. And Lord, I pray that you would open our eyes and enlighten us as we continue this study, that we might, Lord, be vessels for you, that we might be working on this earth in a manner that glorifies you and that you shine through us. We give you all the praise and the glory in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. God bless you. I forgot the announcements before I started to preach. October 6th, we'll be having a pastor appreciation dinner. And there will also be an election there to fill the term of the trustee position that is vacant. So if all members could be there so we can have a quorum. But October 6th will be our pastor appreciation dinner. We'll also have a short business meeting to hold an election for that trustee's position. God bless you. Amen. Have a good day.